This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Coming to Northeast Wisconsin live from the Civic Media Studios and featuring TV and radio broadcast veteran John Mino, along with the City of Green Bay's longest serving mayor, Jim Schmidt. This is Mino and the Mayor.
Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive.
And here are your hosts, John Mino and Jim Schmidt.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome back. Get a good look at Tuesday morning. Question for you, why are all the flags half-mast?
Well, yesterday, which was a great ceremony across the street at Schreiber, they maybe just in honor of Veterans Day
maybe?
Because they brought them down, obviously, and then they just put them up to
half-mast. I mean, I could see that more for Memorial Day.
Yeah,
I didn't know if that's is a national thing for today to be down. I don't know.
No, I don't know. And then they had the electric guitar guy came out and played Jimi Hendrix version.
Oh, no kidding.
Pretty cool.
I'll bet. Oh, that's really neat. That's really neat.
And a lot of people were there, too. I was surprised. I mean, that's
awesome.
Chris Schreiber has
Over across the street here at the after the thing at Duck Creek over at the Neville Museum. They've got the, and they had an honor guard there and everything.
Yeah.
But, man, was it cold.
Yes.
Holy crap.
Well, it wasn't that cold in the morning. This was at, 10 after 8 or something?
This was probably 11-ish.
Yeah, no, it wasn't that cold. It wasn't that windy.
But that wind was coming off that river just crazy.
We were sitting here in the studio yesterday doing some work, and just down Washington Street in Green Bay, the leaves were just blowing, and then, stuff that was out on the sidewalk, I think, a cigarette butt thing came flying by.
Oh, I've seen that a few times.
It was that windy. Yeah.
No, it's crazy.
But, hey, driving in this morning, and kudos to all our Northeast Wisconsin. All the wreaths are up. Did you see that?
No.
All lit up, which is kind of cool. Yeah. It's a little bit early. I mean, Thanksgiving is a couple weeks away, but so am I.
All right. I was going to talk to Jeff the other night, Jeff Merkus.
Yeah, he was there.
Jeff, if you're listening, we will pay for our trees to be lit up the way they are a block away. Those look so cool with those blue lights last Christmas. I want to be able to look out of the window early in the morning and see Christmas decorations on our trees here.
Is that Schreiber, though? Would they be in charge of that?
That's the city's land.
Okay.
But Schreiber's responsible for cutting it. Just like in front of your house, right? You got the sidewalk, you got the curb, that land in between there is the city's land. You can't plant corn or anything in there, but you're responsible for cutting it.
And I want our whole window here decorated.
We'd have to do the window because that's our property. But those trees, I think, could be a partnership.
Yes.
That would be cool.
I know.
Those are pretty easy. Not easy. Nothing's easy, but those wouldn't be that hard to put lights around.
I could do it myself.
There's no leaves.
I could do it myself. I built what I call my Finlander light hanging thing.
That's specific.
Well, I took one of those telescopic paint things.
Yep.
And I took a paint roller and I adapted it to just have a U thing. I bent it, put it in my vise, bent it, attached that. I can reach up to 30 feet now to put it. If anybody wants to hire me out, let me know. I work cheap to help you with your lights outside. What do you think about that?
I think I would go to my neighbor two houses down. He's got a cherry picker. He's got the truck.
It's his home. He's got a truck?
A cherry picker, a truck.
I've always wanted to go up in one of those.
Yeah. Well, I've been up.
I never have.
I would put up the decorations.
I didn't know if I'd get nervous, though, because I'm not great with heights.
But you control it in front of you.
If you guys work it out, maybe we can do that one morning live on the air.
I think that'd be awesome.
Mino out there with the cherry picker putting up lights.
My Finlander light thing?
Don't you want to use the cherry picker?
Well, I want to show people what I created.
That is taller than you think.
Oh, I know.
I couldn't reach that top.
Mino's trees are all halfway down.
Right.
You could
do the trunks.
I get it. I'll tell you something. I was a good friend of mine. Well, okay. So it was yesterday. A friend of mine said, hey, did you hear about a mutual friend, okay? Mm-hmm. I go, no, what? He said he was helping a guy, and he fell off the ladder or whatever, 10 feet, shattered his back.
Ouch. Oh, man.
Busted his legs. He's in a body cast from 10 feet. I have done at least 3 or 4 benefits for guys that fell out of tree stands and got paralyzed. Height is such a dangerous thing, and it doesn't have to be 40 feet. 10, it was like 8 to 10 feet.
Yeah.
Wow.
No, that's...
devastating injury.
Yeah, no, I... it's how... because you don't... people don't know how to break their fall, right? I mean, you just... wow. Yeah, it doesn't... uh-uh.
But you look at it and say, oh, well, that's nothing. I'm not going to get hurt.
I agree.
It's like, whoa.
I agree.
Yep.
So...
I got here. Find out who painted the windows at the Brown County Library. Awesome job.
Good. Yeah.
I haven't seen awesome. It. I'd pay extra to see John up in the cherry picker and using his Finlander thing at the same time.
That could get to the tippy top of the tree.
That's another one. Idea. Why does it always come back to cherries with Jim?
What?
Did you used to make cherry bounce?
No, I didn't.
I wanted to make some for Christmas, but is it too late? Todd, you seem like your family would have made cherry bounce.
No.
No?
Because isn't that old? It's always brandy slush. Yep.
You know what?
Okay. But isn't that like 6 months they have to marinate?
I don't know.
Oh, by the way, speaking of Finlanders, my buddy, Jimmy Jukala, sent me this. You want to marinate your steak? Worcestershire.
Yep.
Low sodium soy.
All right.
Honey.
Okay. Yep.
Garlic salt.
Yep.
Dijon mustard.
Ooh, that sounds good.
That sounds that good marinade. Does. That would be good. How long?
He didn't say.
Okay. Like, you know, day.
I would say day or overnight, right?
So okay. Six put it to in a Ziploc bag, throw it in the fridge, and then throw it in your car and take it up there.
Remember I told you the only wild game I didn't like was goose?
Yeah.
Okay. And duck. Yeah. Had lunch with a Vietnam vet last week. Big outdoor game guy. He'll marinate it for like 3 days.
Oh, yeah. No.
And see, like when I had it, it was not marinated at all.
Nope. Yep.
But he said, you marinate it.
It's out the gamey stuff.
Exactly. No, and they said, he serves it for Christmas. Everybody loves it.
Well, goose. The goose, that's like, you know, right. That's
so I might try that. I think the next time I walk the trail, I'm just take a golf club, knock one off, and take it back here.
No.
Get it out by the river.
Can't
do that?
No, I don't think you can do that.
There is, I got to be honest with you.
There are a lot of geese.
There is still so much goose crap on the Fox River Trail. It's mind-boggling. You have to watch every step you take. Don't they go south? No.
I thought they did.
Is life too good for them here that they don't need to because the water's warm enough?
No, they'll take off.
When?
Soon.
Get out of here.
No, they do. They fly. No, geese don't stay here.
And they've got that same thing
that
horses
have.
They're
flying over you all the time, right? Like in the fall.
But isn't it? Get out of here, time.
Yeah, better head south. It's really close. Yeah.
Go through Missouri and get shot.
Well, but there's geese all year round at the wildlife sanctuary, isn't there? I mean, I've been there in the winter.
Yeah. I think if the water's warm enough, they'll stay.
Yeah.
I think that's
sure
the key.
Not warm enough here on the
Fox. I know. That's what I was thinking.
Yeah. They must, at that Rush Falls, maybe they.
Well, what about out here by the, don't they have a discharge at the electrical plant?
Yeah.
On the bay?
True. Yeah.
And that's how it's warm. Because in Marquette, where I'm from. I don't know if this was healthy, but where they have the discharge coming out of the electric company, it was called Hot Pond or Warm Pond, where people could swim there then. So otherwise, it's Lake Superior, but it'd be so cold otherwise.
People swam?
Oh, that's like a really popular beach.
Don't you? That does not sound like a good idea.
I agree. I agree, in retrospect.
And you get up and there's ice under you, above you?
No, it never freezes.
No, but. Well, eventually it does if it's Lake Superior, right? So you got this like...
No,
what,
but this one part 30? Doesn't because it's always warm water coming right out of the plant.
Okay. I thought the plant... Eventually it freezes, right? Because
water
goes
further
somewhere.
Out. Yeah.
Okay.
But this is moving water and it's warm as it comes in.
And what I'm saying is I would hate to get caught in that current and taken out to where there... It's
I like, don't think it's ever happened. Okay. Seriously. And there That's are currents good. In like, oh my gosh, there's I, so I, many. I mean, if you go to a beach around Marquette, around Lake Superior now.
Totally.
They've got those rescue things hanging on trees because that current is, they got like a tide, like a rip tide current.
Oh man.
And the water is so cold, it literally paralyzes people. And there's this island on this one beautiful area, just beautiful. And I hate to say it, but you get a lot of these kids from like lower Michigan. Who just, oh man, this is awesome.
It looks like fun.
Who doesn't, they don't have any idea how cold it is. And
they don't
appreciate
the undercurrent.
And they don't appreciate the current.
Yeah.
Horrible tragedies up there because of that. I mean, big signs. And it looks so friendly, you know, user friendly or whatever you want to call it. But it's just, it's terrible.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm almost glad I don't know how to swim. Because I think I would have been reckless if I did swim.
Yeah. You know what? So you just never went in.
So I never went in. Yeah, I mean, I'd wade. That's all I could do.
No, that's. Yeah, that,
I
no,
can
that's
swim the length of a pool.
Well, then you can swim. Maybe you can swim
one
to shore.
Length. One length,
that's fine. You can swim to shore. The boat, if you fell out of the boat, could you swim to shore? That's the question.
I would never go on a boat without a life jacket.
Well,
never, ever, 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 ever. That's and
good.
You know another thing? I always wear like flip-flops or easy-to-take-off shoes. That scares. Swimming scares me.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Well, waters, man.
That took away my, because I wanted to be a Navy SEAL, and that's, I think, that one of the reasons why I could get in.
I'm sure that's the only reason.
I think so, too. Yeah. I still don't know why I didn't get in the CIA. Remember I told you I tried to apply for the CIA?
Yes, I do. I'm not.
Wouldn't I be a good CIA guy?
No, John. I mean, well, I don't know. Yeah, maybe you would have. I don't know.
Todd?
Have the test. Right?
I'm not sure. Maybe.
I'll take that as a positive.
Yeah. Do you guys remember Crossroads 41 down in Oshkosh? It was the first year of a bunch of bands. They
announced it.
They just announced it this morning.
Saw that.
Cody Johnson, Kane Brown, and Parker McCollum will headline. That is coming up August 7th through the 9th in Oshkosh. And tickets will go on sale this Friday at 10 a.m.
Kane Brown is hugely popular.
They do it big down there in Oshkosh.
Yeah, they do.
That's going to be a great event. Three-day passes, I'm sure they got, plus or one individuals. Yeah, that's...
That used to be a fun place.
And they get that VIP section. Remember that?
Yeah.
You can kind of see.
Yeah.
That'd be pretty cool.
At your event...
Mm-hmm.
Was the upstairs a VIP thing, or could people just go
anybody
up there?
Go up there.
Oh, okay.
Which is cool, because I got a few people sent me pictures, because at the Northland, you know, like the Crystal Ballroom, you know, can seat so many people, but then they have that upper balcony to look down on, and that's pretty cool. Yeah,
that's very cool.
Yeah, that's
if people haven't been there, go over there and just wander around. It is still one of the coolest things in all of Green Bay.
And they gave tours, too, that night.
Yeah.
I don't know if you took one, but...
I did not.
8-11
is... I've never seen the bowling alley.
Yeah, and that
I know a bunch of people went down and bowled that night.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
And then they got billiards, and then the upstairs. You know, there's 8 floors there, obviously, but 8-11 is like the presidential suite.
I think pool is the only sport you could beat me at.
Oh, I don't know about that.
You grew up with a pool table.
I thought about ping pong, foosball.
You had those
bowling.
Too.
You had all of those.
No,
your
I'm
house.
Just saying that oh. you said pool's the only one I can beat you at. I think.
Yeah. What else?
Well, if you have a pool table, you have a ping pong table.
We like, should have a little bit of top. A decathlon, you against me and stuff like
but
that.
But we had a ping pong table, but that's not like everybody had. If you had
okay,
a pool
we
table,
did not,
like,
okay. We did well, not no, have a pool table, did not have ping pong.
You just take that, it was just, what is that, parka board? Or that, and you just laid the two sheets on there, put the net on there. So it was a ping pong table.
Oh,
with
yeah,
the
yeah,
white
yeah,
lines
yeah,
around.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, do we have a ping pong table? I don't know.
You know what our favorite fun thing to do on holidays was? Go to my Uncle Nacho's camp and play bocce ball. And that is now televised on ESPN. And you should see these guys from, like, Italy in that. It's almost like they get so into it, almost like the people here on ice. The
curlers?
Broom hockey?
Curlers.
Yeah.
Oh, curlers.
Curling.
Okay,
yeah.
I got it. Okay.
They take it really serious. Oh, bocce yeah. ball. That used to be a fun sport.
That we didn't do.
No? How about horseshoes?
Yeah.
All right.
A lot of croquet.
You would. Todd, put together a...
everybody played
a
croquet.
A list of events.
What?
Me and him.
Did you play croquet? Everybody plays. Oh, come on.
No.
Did not. Have not.
You get, go through the two things. You get double points. Oh, come on. Oh.
Love it. Love it. Bring out the mallet. Bring out the
give
lucky
a ghosty.
Mallet. Yep. Nope. Okay.
Wow.
We got to set a quick break. We come back. Carrie and Abby Sutherland, Walk to End Alzheimer's, will be joining us.
You're listening to Civic Media. Stay up to date on the latest news and information for your local community and Wisconsin by signing up for our free email newsletter. Visit civicmedia.us/email to get started.
GBW.
Hey, welcome back. Mine on the Mayor here on 97.9 FM WGBW, 98.3 FM WISS, and the Civic Media app. By the way, Jim, a lot of people at your event the other night are big fans of watching high school football.
Yep.
Including your brother.
Oh, yeah.
And others, and they ask who the game is. So it's set. We will televise the Bayport DC Everest game Friday night, coming your way from Titan Stadium in Oshkosh.
Fun.
The weather looks good. I mean, sometimes for this weekend... these poor high school kids are just, you know, freezing out there. But the weather looks great for Friday night football.
Cool.
So all of our local teams that are still in competition for a trip to Camp Randall, that's exciting.
Notre Dame's still in hunt?
Notre Dame's still undefeated. Boy, your neighbor is just unbelievable.
That kid's awesome, isn't he?
He's got to be All-State. He's got to be like first-team All-State. He's been unbelievable.
I got to go see him before he takes. What do they play Saturday? I should know.
Friday.
This. Friday, okay.
And if they win that, they're at Camp Randall.
Really?
Which, can you imagine the thrill running out of Camp Randall?
Yeah, I was
under the tunnel.
I was there when they went last time, which was like what, 2004 or 2005?
No, it's been more recent than that.
Okay.
When they won it, not that long ago. Dom was in high school. So
was it later than that?
10 years ago, maybe?
Oh, it seems longer than that.
Yeah.
Anyway, I got, yes.
Which is unusual, because normally we say, well, that was just a couple of years ago, and then it turns out it was like 18 years I know, ago.
That happens, I think, when you get a little bit older. Hey, two things I just want to, I didn't even tell you when I got here this morning. You know, I wasn't getting messages. Like, you sent me some stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like, I was kind of frustrated. And I was sending some stuff, and it was like, you know how it gives you that, like, exclamation point, message did not send. So I went to bed last night, I was really frustrated. And then I got up this morning, and I was like, because I usually get quite a few messages. It was on airplane mode. And I turned it off airplane mode. Ding, 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 ding.
Wow.
So be careful. That's just my little.
I didn't know that.
That's my piece of advice to our great listeners here. So make sure if you're not getting messages that your phone is not in airplane mode. I don't know how it got on there. Hey, something I want to talk about. Sleep in Heavenly Peace. We've had these guys on here before. They were also nominated at the awards breakfast that we went to. Just a great organization. And what they do, you're going to have a hard time believing this, but there's many kids that don't have beds, sleeping on the floor, or sleeping just on the sofa. And what this organization does, Sleep in Heavenly Peace, is they build bunk beds and then give them to families in need. And they have two things going on this weekend from 9 till noon. You come out and help. You know, you guys are ladies that are like to build things, like you, John. At Great Harvest Bread, 802 George Street in De Pere. So that's one place you can go to between 9 and noon. And then the other place you can go to is their workshop, which is 2132 East Deerfield Avenue in Suamico. So all
great items, organization.
It is. And, you know, twin great. Size.
Great.
It's just a great place you can.
I mean, the difference between them Google doing them. This or some little kids sleeping on the floor
right.
is what they do.
And you think about school and what nothing better than a good night's sleep. So, yep. So they can always use, they can use sheets, pillows, waterproof mattress covers too, you know, whatever. Just look at their website. Look up their website, Sleep in Heavenly Peace for, this is a national organization, but, for Greater Green Bay.
And boy, you want to talk about kids if they need community service hours
right.
and different things
That's,
like that.
You know,
great, yeah. great organization, any social organization. Another great one.
Yes.
Is the organization that And Alzheimer's, Carrie Josephson in the house. Hi, Carrie.
Good morning.
Last time we talked to you, you were just about to, I think it was the day before, you were about to have your walk.
We were.
How did that go?
It was chilly. Yeah. But other, it was like the one cold day.
You're
out
right.
Of the last
I remember
4 months.
That. Yeah. yeah.
So strange. But it was beautiful. Being down on City Good. Deck this year
yeah.
had a wonderful crowd. Yeah. Everyone really enjoyed it. It's a special day.
So. Super. And if nothing else, just get the awareness out there what you guys are doing, right?
Absolutely. Yes.
Cool.
The more people we can get with our message, the better.
And again, we've talked about this. Every person here has had somebody in their family with Alzheimer's, like serious, serious Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. And so each one of us here has a special, you know, a little thing in our heart for this cause. So go ahead and tell us what we can do from here on out.
Awesome.
I just want to underscore Johnny said, though, about 7 million Americans. That's a lot.
That is a lot of people. Absolutely.
And you know what I like? I like the fact that the color is purple and you even use a purple pen.
She always wears purple
See that?
Too.
I know.
Every time she's been in here, she's always styling purple.
Yeah.
I know. No purple dress today, so I have the purple pen.
But there's a little purple in there. I'm colorblind. That looks like okay.
Are you colorblind?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you seriously?
Just for like reds and greens, not like I can
well,
see.
Well, obviously purples too.
I didn't want to say anything. Todd, thank
Thanks,
you.
Todd.
I didn't want to say anything.
That's funny.
But it's like,
that is funny.
It's like, am I missing something here? Where's it?
And purple.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah, whatever. Okay. Is it, when you get those dots
okay.
with the numbers in,
yeah.
you can't mm-hmm. sometimes see the numbers.
Do you know that Vince Lombardi was colorblind?
Oh.
And that's one reason why the Packers uniforms aren't actually gold. But he was looking at the yellow and saying it was gold. But, I mean, the difference between, like, Notre Dame, which is, you know, gold or whatever, is
oh, that's
so different.
Much, it is, you're right.
Yeah.
There's different. So, I remember that was a long time ago when I found that out. But you get those dots, and you
yeah,
have to find a 9, find a 16, and then the guy's like, and I'm like, I don't
well,
know.
Well, you could never be a pilot.
But then he took me outside where the sun was. He thought maybe it was a little
yeah.
dark in the room. But I'm not severely colorblind. There's other people, like, I mean, I know what gold is, but it's just the reds and the greens. Then the guy's like to me, okay, when it's The light at the bottom, then you can go. Like, I'm not like, well, like I'm like, give me a break. I'm not that colorblind.
I was watching a show, one of those DIY shows, and this guy built this beautiful indoor barn door for somebody for their thing. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm going to stain it, you know, such and such. And I'm looking, it's like, yeah, what an ugly, beautiful door. What I'm going to come. So they go to commercial, comes like, okay, folks, I'm going to be up front with you. I'm colorblind. And I thought it was so. And he had to sand off that entire door. He said, it took me 2 weeks to get this done. Yeah. But he was colorblind. Yeah. But I was watching. It's like, what an ugly color. Oh. And he thought it was gorgeous.
And I don't think that improves. I think it is what it
if
is.
If you got it, you, got it.
You got it. Yeah. It's not like, well, I'm going to learn. But yeah. It's just mine isn't severe. There's people that are a lot more colorblind.
No, this is a beautiful purple dress Carrie's wearing. Right, Todd?
Right.
I don't think it's too severe at all,
oh,
Jim.
Oh, man. China. Okay.
It's a nice red pullover you got, though. Hi, Carrie.
Oh, man.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm great. How are you, too?
Good.
So, Carrie, yeah. Your region is more than Brown County, right? Don't you?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Tell me what you oversee.
And Door County, right?
Right.
Yes. Yeah. So I manage the walks in Green Bay and Door County. But as far as Green Bay, it goes quite far. We have people coming for the walk in Green Bay all the way from Marinette.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
You know, the number one thing we talked about last time, Carrie, which was encouraging, was I think we're just on the precipice, correct me if I'm wrong, of advancements in diagnosis and you can't say heading it off at the pass, but at least getting a little bit of a handle on it, right?
Oh, for sure. Big things coming for with diagnosis.
We're going to talk a bunch about that as soon as we come back, okay?
Okay.
Carrie Josephson is here. Walk to End Alzheimer's. She is awesome at what she does. Back right after this.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
East Wisconsin, live from the Civic Media Studios and featuring TV and radio broadcast veteran John Mino, along with the city of Green Bay's longest serving mayor, Jim Schmidt. This is Mino and the Mayor.
Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive.
And here are your hosts, John Mino and Jim Schmidt.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome back. Mine with the Mayor here, 97.9 FM, WGBW, 98.3 FM, WISS, Civic Media app. And we're going to try really hard to not breathe on Carrie Josephson.
I know.
Because we got some
crud. Are you sick?
Oh, no. Yeah, it's just, we're not, it's weird. It's, just
it's
a,
weird. I wish something would hit harder
fine.
So you know what it
it's
is.
It's more of the throat, but you don't want to get this.
Gotcha.
Todd doesn't go away here. Todd brought it here.
I did not. Jim did. Remember?
Nah, I don't think so. I don't think so. The upside is.
You don't think so.
I went to work out with my trainer, and she goes, "You're too sick. Why don't you go home?" Which was cool.
Oh.
So that, and it, I don't feel bad.
Yeah,
it just sounds worse. It was nice.
Silver lining.
It was.
It's the great.
I felt like I was going like I gotta get sent home from school. You know. It's like,
hey,
good.
Let me ask him. No. As soon as she said that, did you go? Yeah. If you really think so, because I really do feel
do
like working
you.
Out.
You know
today.
What?
Thank you for that.
I wish I could stay in school.
Yeah, I'll just go home and do some push-ups.
Yeah.
Yeah, you went home. You had your feet up so fast. Let's be honest. Carrie, how you doing with the fight against Alzheimer's? Because you are in the trench. You
absolutely.
Are not even the trenches. You are in the front row.
Yes, absolutely am. Walk is over, but fundraising continues. And we still have a lot of great events going on. And this Friday, the Attacking Alls volleyball game is coming up with UWGB.
Is it Friday?
It's Friday already.
Okay.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Is there something going on tonight that you're involved with? Or no?
No.
Something with volleyball? No. Okay.
Nope.
Because Nikki talked
Friday.
To me about something. Okay. That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so this Friday, the women play out at the Cross Event Center at 6 p.m. We're going to have a bit of a pregame reception before, and there are going to be lots of vendors there with information and resources.
Okay.
So if anyone is a caregiver or is living with Alzheimer's or dementia, we'll have lots of information.
And I don't think anybody's going to get out of this world without having somebody that has it.
And
I mean, I hate to say it.
Talk about millions and millions of caregivers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And they sometimes don't know what's out there. the resources. So I think I like when you bring everything under one roof because, you know, this driving all over or getting online and trying to find stuff.
Well, I read something I was all excited about. I was like, wow, there's this new drug they're talking about. You know, you read the headlines and then you just brought it back to reality.
Yes.
Because like I said, you're in the trenches.
Yes. But, and very exciting stuff.
Right.
Some new diagnostics with a blood test coming and, you know, two new drugs that actually do slow the progression. Unfortunately, it slows the progression in a very small population of people.
Okay.
You have to catch it early. There are some potential very serious side effects.
See, the article I read with the headlines said nothing about that part. Mm-hmm. But what did you say, Jim? Why they do that? For investors or whatever?
Honestly, it's still incredibly exciting. We haven't had anything this. So it's hope. It helps people.
Right.
It has to be monitored very closely.
I mean, up until not that many years ago. I mean, Todd, if you don't mind me asking you, like when your dad had it, it was just basically keep him comfortable and whatever, right? Was there any way of combating it?
I mean, he was on medication, but at some point you just have to say, well, it's not beneficial anymore. I don't want to put you on the spot, Carrie, but how early is too early? If you have worries about it, you have it in your family, maybe you're starting to wonder about yourself.
And during the break, I was asking her about a friend of mine.
Mm-hmm.
How early is too early to go in and say, hey, I'm a little worried about this?
Honestly, I don't think there is such a thing as too early. Even if it's not, you know, anything that truly is a concern at the moment.
Right.
It's always good to go in, get checked out, at least get a baseline established.
That's got to be a tough conversation to have with a loved one, isn't it?
Oh, for sure.
But can those blood tests give you a heads up?
Genetically, like?
So there is a genetic component. Typically genetics, or I should say it's a small percentage of people.
That it's genetic.
That's a load off my mind.
No question.
There's also the family history component, which those are kind of separate things. So it can be genetic. Also, family history comes into play because typically then you have a similar lifestyle. You grew up in the same area, same level of activity, types of foods you eat.
We talk about that. There are tests that can tell you some not good things, and some people just choose not to take the test.
Yeah, because a lot of times with those tests, it just tells you if you have an increased risk.
Okay.
Okay, you said something interesting. I don't know if you just said it in passing, I think, but you said about with family type things, because they lived in the same area, same type of food, all those things. Are there environmental factors that they think might be a cause of this?
It could be environmental, also just lifestyle in general.
Like what?
Being sedentary isn't good, so you need to be moving. Typically, people from the same family have a similar lifestyle.
Sure.
So, you know, if you're a very active family, you tend to stay active, whether that be socially, physically, both.
Boy, they say getting off the couch. Even reading about blood pressure, one of the things, the guy had a list of things. Number one was get off the bleeping couch.
Yes.
You know, move.
But
that's becoming, in our day, Jim, our parents worked all the time, or they were always moving.
Well, come home and watch TV.
Exactly. But now it's
I think what Carrie's saying, though, our doctors are saying, or our personal trainers, get off the couch. It's good for your mental health, too. And
right.
I think that's what you're kind of saying.
Yes. Yeah. So, getting off the couch, staying active socially, just, challenging your brain, but also keeping your heart healthy. Heart means a healthy brain.
So at this thing on Friday, this volleyball, which is just catching fire. I mean, people are so into volleyball right now. Who's there? What are some of the vendors who will be having tables and people we can talk to?
First I should thank our sponsors. Forget Me Not Fund, US Venture, and IT Savvy are sponsoring the event. Forget Me Not Fund will be there with information, a fantastic resource in the community. We'll also have Curative Connections may have some information out.
Oh, yeah.
The ADRC will be there, the Dementia Friendly Coalition. I know Care Patrol is going to be there. So lots of good resources
for that's
people.
Great.
And of course, the Alzheimer's Association.
Now, you said it's not, Jim asked the question, how early should you go? What kind of testing do they do? I mean, not to make light of it, but, with Trump talking about a cognitive test and this and that, is that what you do, sort of?
I think first it just starts with a conversation with your doctor.
Okay.
But if the doctor is concerned, then they would move to a cognitive test.
Okay. And we're talking about treatments. And again, I got taken by that headline, whatever. And I was excited to talk to you about it. And it's not as great as they made it sound. But in the last 5, 6, 10 years from, years ago when they just would let these people just whatever. Mm-hmm. What do you feel is the greatest achievement, the greatest stride, the greatest thing to fight back with? What do you see? And again, you're in the trenches. What can you say, hey, that was a breakthrough?
I would say, honestly, it's twofold. First of all, it's great that we just see more and more people that are actually talking about it.
Right.
There used to be such a stigma, and there is still.
I didn't want to use that word, but you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of times people are just afraid to bring it up in conversation.
Yes.
Or to admit that they either are concerned or have been diagnosed or have a family member who has. And that's going away more and more, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
But also, you know, even though there are some real downsides to these treatments, it's still amazing that we have them. Prior to this, the only drugs that we had would only treat symptoms. They
right.
didn't actually slow the progression or change the course of the disease in any way. So to have this, while there are some potential major side effects from them, they still really help a segment of the population that is affected with Alzheimer's.
People
so it's
a lot of times,
fantastic.
Oh, I'm sorry, I mean, people a lot of times are afraid to make the call to a doctor. Okay. Mm-hmm. Can they call you? Can they call your people and,
yes.
and tell you some things and you guys kind of give them guidance before that? You know, there's that white coat syndrome
yeah.
kind of about talking to a doctor.
Right.
You're afraid what they're going to say.
And I think sometimes it's just confusing. You don't know, you know, what is normal aging versus
exactly
a concern or something that you should have checked out. We have a 24/7 helpline that's available to anyone for
that's
any question
awesome.
Whatsoever. So people can definitely call there. You know, whether you're wondering if it's something that you should talk to a doctor about, or maybe you do want to talk to a doctor and you're not sure where to go first. You know, anybody can help call the helpline with any question that they have and get some guidance.
That's awesome.
Can you give
that's
us that number.
I'm gonna
yep. We're gonna put it on our website. But
you bet.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yes, I will give you the number.
All right.
Now, are you guys when you guys do some of these things? I'm sure you have people like Jim and I and Todd who have had somebody, you know, dealt with this,
mm-hmm.
and they come up to you and ask you all kinds of questions. Do you almost feel like, okay, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a whatever, don't bank on me letting you know, where this stands versus you being the conduit to helping them? But I'm sure there are people that come up to you, and it's almost like that. I told you the guy I was talking to the other day, he's a male nurse, and again, I know I'm not, but still, so he's a nurse, and he'll walk into a room at this nursing home type thing, and they'll be like, oh, doctor, it's so good to see you. And well, then the real doctor will come in who's a female, oh, dear, yeah. Would you mind refilling my
fluff up my pillow? Yeah. Anyway, we got ways to go on that. But what these early signs, and you don't want to overreact.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, Johnny's talking about, you know, you can call the helpline. But let's talk a little bit more about the caregivers who their loved one has been diagnosed.
God bless them.
And right?
Absolutely.
And that's it. Again, you know, I mean, I was exposed to Alzheimer's in a sad way, but it's just 24/7. It's just, it's not like
you don't get away from it.
No, it's not like you got a cold and then get a little bit better.
Oh, you feel I'm better today.
Right.
Nope.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It's incredibly difficult to be a caregiver and difficult on the caregivers. And, you know, that being said, it's so important that caregivers take care of themselves because it is a job that's 24/7. And, you know, the helpline is really there for them as well.
Oh.
And I know we said we would share this online, but the number is 1-800-272-3900.
Okay, there's been movies, and I know we've had somebody in here talk about this, where they'll bring people back to a certain time, like before they had the Alzheimer's,
mm-hmm.
and that puts them in a really good place, even temporarily. Could you expound on that a little bit?
Oh, yeah. I think it's just, it's a comfort factor. And that's where I think you see so often that, you know, music is really calming for people if you play music that they're familiar with. Also, even, you know, Curative Connection has an amazing facility with the Yesteryear Village.
That's what I was talking about, yeah.
63 or 4, I don't know what they... It's kind of that kind of time frame. It's
exactly.
not the 20s, you know, it's not the 70s.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not good cure, but it puts them in a nice
right.
place, right?
And that's what you want is you don't reduces anxiety and it,
exactly.
And
it's comforting.
Well, it's kind of good for the caregiver, too, because it can be a little
frustrating. Oh, yeah.
God bless those people, man.
All these same questions
yeah.
over. But it's that's
no,
great
it is,
that they have that.
It is stressful. And it certainly it is frustrating at times. And I think it's important just to remember that. You know, you really have to meet the person that you're caring for where they're at.
Right,
right.
You know, a lot of times I think people, they're hearing the same stories over and over, or, you know, they're hearing the same incorrect information because, you know, the person they're caring for says this happened yesterday and it didn't.
The sad part
you just
is
have
when
to
they,
go with it.
When you think they're in this other place, you know, in their mind,
mm-hmm.
and you're kind of, you're going with that, and then all of a sudden they will pop back into right now, right here, this moment. And it's almost like scary how it goes back and forth, isn't it though?
And all of a sudden they have a moment of clarity.
Yes.
And they seem totally fine.
100%. Mm-hmm. That's the part that's, it's like, oh, that's the real you, mm-hmm. you know? And that's kind of heartbreaking almost at times.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Heartbreaking and I think neat to see all
absolutely
at the same time.
Right. To see the real person.
Absolutely. Okay.
I give you all the credit in the world and everybody that's involved
with
Alzheimer's.
Me. No. Credit goes out to the caregivers, honestly.
Well, they have but you wake up every morning trying to do what you can to make sure we have those caregivers.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be honest. If it wasn't for an organization like yours, this would still be like, you know, in a back room type thing and nobody's talking about it.
True.
I'm assuming one of the biggest struggles with the caregivers is time off.
Absolutely. Yes.
And what's a remedy for that?
You know, I think it's important, first of all, to have a great care team. You know, it can't all just fall on the shoulders of one person.
Yeah, the oldest daughter or something. That
right.
It's like, come on.
Yeah. So it's really important, you know, whether it's friends, family, neighbors, you know, have kind of a care team that can help.
Right.
Also, you know, there are other organizations where you can bring in home care, you know, whether it's just for a couple hours, 1 or 2 days a week, or if you have, you know, 3 or 4 days, you know, whatever the level of care is that you need, there are organizations out there that you can bring in, or there are day programs available that you can take the person you're caring for.
Okay, I gotta ask,
and you have all that for people. I mean,
there are resources in the community.
Yes. That's what's
awesome. We're gonna set a quick break. You stick around. Mm-hmm. So something I want to talk to you about. There's a commercial on now about when the people like turn violent, kind of towards like angry. I mean, to be a caregiver. For some of those types of situations, just special place in heaven for those kind of people. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
All right. We'll be back with this very, very somber subject, but it's also a very, very positive subject.
You're making inroads.
You're making inroads and you're bringing this out to the surface that people never used to talk about. Carrie Josephson and Alzheimer's. Big event taking place this Friday night at the Crest Center. Back after this.
15 cars and 15 restless riders. 3 conductors and 25 sacks on mail. All along the southbound Odyssey, the train pulls out at Kankakee and rolls along past houses, farms, and fields. Passing trains that have no name and freight yards full of old black men in the graveyard.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
With their babes asleep, rocking to the gentle beat and the rhythm.
All right, welcome back, everybody. We're talking about a sensitive subject, but one that is making a lot of progress, and it's Alzheimer's. A lot of stuff going on, and our focus, while it's on the person who has Alzheimer's, we really need to focus on the caregiver.
Oh, absolutely.
All the respect in the world.
Right.
Yes. Caregivers, angels, absolutely. You know, it's such a difficult job, but also so important.
Yeah.
I mean, there are over 11 million unpaid caregivers in the U.S., which is staggering. So that's,
thank you, Nikki.
You know, aside from all the people that work in senior care facilities and,
right.
and
wow.
such as that. But exciting with the Attacking Alls game, we're actually, the team is offering up free tickets for any caregiver. So whether you're a family caregiver, a professional caregiver, there's a link on our Facebook, in our Facebook group, or feel free to reach out to me and I can get that to you. All you have to do is request a free ticket prior to the game.
Carrie, what is your mission? What is your goal? You're not going to cure it. Obviously, you know what I mean?
Oh, eventually we will.
Okay, when you wake up every morning.
Keep people positive. That's
what are
goal.
You, yeah, what is your number one goal in dealing with Alzheimer's?
Honestly, number one goal is just to spread awareness and education. You know, that's so important, and I think that's really the base for everything, because that's what will lead to more fundraising, which leads to more research and more breakthroughs, more treatments,
and eventually
cure.
You hate to say it, but I will say this, Jim, you hit it on the head earlier when we were talking about that thing. It all comes down to that, doesn't it?
It does. I mean, you need money, and that's why Bruce Willis, some of these other people, it's like, I know it's sad, but it's kind of okay. It's like, look what happened.
It just helps get people talking about it more.
It does, and look at Robin Williams and the whole suicide. I mean, that just really elevated, you know, that cause. But there's good things going on. And in November, coming up November 19th, a research update. And I think that'd be interesting for people like Johnny and I to hear, but also caregivers and family members. So tell us a little bit about that.
Okay, and then I'm going to do a follow-up on that.
Yeah.
I want to talk more about those tests. I would literally like to take... Okay, I'm just going to be honest here. I'm not joking about this. Okay, and this, you would relate to this, Jim. The other day at Walmart, I thought my car was stolen. I could have sworn I'd parked in a certain thing, and I went up and down probably 5 or 6 rows. Mm-hmm. And I was at the point where, because I have a Kia, which are easiest to, I thought, my car is stolen. And then I finally realized where it was. And you deal with that too. Let's be honest. Whenever we go someplace, I always have to find your car for you.
Oh, I think we all deal with that to some degree.
Okay, but the thing is, that happens to me rarely. Todd and I are keeping track, and we're going to connect the dots, and then we're going to go see Carrie and say, hey, John, this is...
But little things like that, is that a sign? I would like to take one of those tests.
You know, you really have to look at the bigger picture.
I thought it was stolen.
Don't overreact.
And I don't know how to use the...
You're stressed out.
I don't know how to use that button.
Yeah, I mean, Jim makes a good point. It could be stress. Also, I think, you know, we live in such a fast-paced society, and we're always, you know, communicating in 5 different ways all at the same time. You know, we're emailing and texting and on the phone, and probably also, you know, on our way into the store and thinking about what we need to get when we get there.
John,
and
have I ever lost my phone?
Oh my god!
Every day,
yeah.
So, have you ever lost a quarter?
You know, I just
I could have sworn I had a quarter.
It happens to me, and I don't think there's anything wrong with me. I just think I'm.
But remember, I told you guys at that event a couple weeks ago, and I had that lady at the stadium view. I had asked her to help me find my car.
Yes, that's true. Well, but you're kind of a little bit, you know, scattered. That's a more scatterbrain. That's an Alzheimer's. Okay,
I'm told to take a test though. Could I?
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, November 19th. Tell us about that, Carrie.
Yes. So November 19th, we're actually bringing a speaker up from Madison. So the Alzheimer's Association is partnering with the Dementia Friendly Coalition and offering an event. It's completely free for anyone to attend, open to the public. It's going to be at the Neville Museum and starts at 1 p.m. So we're just going to go through and talk a bit about some of the recent research updates.
What can we do, Carrie?
I want to emphasize that. A research update, because I think people think we're stuck in neutral on this thing, but does progress being made?
Oh, always. Yes.
And legit, you're coming from a legit point versus what I told you I read about that I was excited about. I mean,
is still something to be excited about, though.
Okay.
I know there are downsides, but there are with every new advancement.
Carrie, where's your passion? I mean, you could have any job you wanted, I'm sure, in marketing or public relations or sales or anything you want to do, and you decided to devote your life to this. Can I just ask you why?
You know, at first, I just wanted to get back into nonprofit work because I really enjoy helping people. And now, I mean, once you get in the role and meet all the people that are attending WALK and part of the planning committee... and, you know, working with, like, the Sutherlands, for example, this is the 5th annual Attacking Alls game, and, you know, you get to know them, and you want to do it for them, too.
Awesome.
And it's the real people. I mean, there's a lot of great people, but, I mean, the real people are in these nonprofits, because, like Johnny just said, you could do other things, but you get in there, you get the cause, and then you see the upside. I mean, I don't know that we're going to end homelessness, but we're sure going to help it. And I don't know that you're going to end Alzheimer's, but you're sure going to help it. You know what I mean?
Oh, for sure. Eventually we'll end it. I hope it's in my lifetime.
Yeah.
I keep saying I would love to work myself out of a job. Would love to.
Yeah.
There is nothing that I would like more than to actually have a cure for Alzheimer's so that I don't have to do this anymore.
I think that's awesome. I'm really looking forward to that, that research update.
Oh. We actually got a really great text from Gary. He sent in a website, the Wisconsin Registry for Alzheimer's Prevention through UW Wisconsin. And there's testing. There's how you can participate in this. So we'll also have that on our blog, on our website as well at wgbw.fm or wiss.fm.
Awesome.
Yeah, and honestly, there are so many different research projects and trials that are going on, and they are always looking for people, people, whether they have Alzheimer's or dementia or are completely healthy, but just people to participate in these trials because it helps advance the research.
We're running out of time, but how much is hereditary? Like your family, is it?
As far as actual genetic, it is a very small percentage that's hereditary.
Okay, good.
One last quick question for you.
Mm-hmm.
And you said you hope to work yourself out of a job.
Yeah.
Okay. How close do you think that possibly could be?
It's so hard to say.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
Because we're still just scratching the surface. But
we are.
Who knows? There might be there might be some miracle drug or something. Who knows?
Yeah, but we've made some amazing advancements, and now we have AI, which I feel like is just going to speed things up.
It will.
So
awesome. Carrie Josephson. Walk to End Alzheimer's coming up Friday. Well, this is an event for volleyball Friday at the Crest Center, Crest Event Center, 6 o'clock. Thank you for all you're doing for all of our people around here.
Oh, thank you for having me. And hope to see lots of people out there. 6 p.m., Crest Event Center, UWGB.
Whatever we can do to help promote anything you got doing, you got it, okay?
Thank you.
All right.
800-272-3900.
And I promise I'll do your walk next year if it's warmer.
His dedication.
I will put that on the order form.
Right.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.